Good morning. Today we celebrate the solemnity of Christ the King. Let's stand and join in our entrance song, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
To all of you.
Good morning.
Let us continue in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. This morning, the church celebrates our Lord Jesus Christ, the King of the universe. The feast that we celebrate as we end our ordinary time. And today's gospel invites us. There is a gospel that the verse that really transformed the life of Mother Teresa. Whatever you do to the least of my brothers and sisters, you have done unto me. And whatever works of mercy that we do in our life, it reaches to God. And so for the times we have failed to be merciful and to be kind, to be compassionate to our fellow brothers and sisters, let us ask the Lord for pardon and mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have given us the consolation of truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd who has shown us the way to eternal life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us and forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Thanks for your great glory.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, whose will is to restore all things in your beloved Son, the King of the universe, grant, we pray, that the whole creation set free from slavery may render your majesty service and ceaselessly proclaim your praise through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will look after and tend my sheep. As a shepherd tends his flock when he finds himself among his scattered sheep, so will I tend my sheep. I will rescue them from every place where they are scattered, and when it was cloudy and dark. I myself will pasture my sheep. I myself will give them rest, says the Lord God. The lost I will seek out, the strayed I will bring back, the injured I will bind up, the sick I will heal, but the sleek and the strong I will destroy, shepherding them rightly. As for you, my sheep, says the Lord God, I will judge between one sheep and another, between rams and goats. The word of the Lord.
He revives my soul.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through man, the resurrection of the dead came also through man. For us, just as in Adam all die, so too in Christ shall all be brought to life, but each one in proper order. Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father, when he has destroyed every sovereignty and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. When everything is subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who subjected everything to him, so that God may be all in all. The word of the Lord. Thanks.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations be assembled before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you? And the king will reply, Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of the least brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill and in prison, and you did not care for me. Then they will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs? He will answer them, Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. And these will go off to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord. What is your spirit animal? You might be familiar with this concept. It was originally a Lakota rite of passage for adolescents, where they would go off on a spirit quest and find a companion who would guide them. It's become a part of our pop culture. We often choose an animal whose qualities that we like, or maybe we would like for ourselves. A lot of us choose NFL mascots, you know, the type of jungle cat or bird of prey. My spirit animal is a grizzly bear. My son's is a Tyrannosaurus Rex. I think Will Oosley's is probably a griffin. Maybe. He said, leave me alone, I'm trying to stream the mass. Jesus also has a spirit animal that we hear about in our readings today. Can you guess what it is? It's also one of the four animals that is depicted in the artwork in our church. I'm sure you see it. Can you point to it? It's behind me and above me, in the arms of St. Agnes, the sheep or the lamb. Above her is the dove, the symbol of the Holy Spirit. And we also have the third, an eagle, on the standard of the Roman soldiers in our Stations of the Cross. The fourth animal is a secret that I'll tell you about in my homily on the third Sunday of Advent. So come back for that. Sheep seem like an unusual choice for a spirit animal. We have very negative connotations in our culture with sheep. If you were to say to someone, you are such a sheep, it would be considered an insult. We associate sheep with stupidity, with a blind following of others, with innocence, with a lot of those qualities that we do not consider positive. This is not the way that the ancient Mediterranean people thought about sheep. Sheep and goats were both beloved animals. People spent a lot of time with these animals. They might have a house goat that stayed in their house with them. And they had such a strong relationship with their sheep that they would use the words for sheep to describe each other. A beloved daughter might be called Tabitha, which is the word for a young ewe. Describing a king as a ram was a mighty compliment. A bond existed between people and animals that we might relate to with our own domestic animals, like our dogs. So it is interesting then that Jesus uses these two animals to represent those that are separated at the end. To the sheep on his right, who attain eternal reward. To the goats on his left. Sorry, you guys are on my left. Nothing personal. He could have used pigs instead of goats, or wolves. Why did he use goats? I did some research this week to try to discover it, and I found about 7 or 8 reasons why. But homilies should only have one idea, so I'm going to keep you with one. And this is a quote I found from a goat herd about her animals. She wrote, "Competition is the name of the game in the goat world. Beginning at birth, kids, that is baby goats, compete with each other for their mother's milk. Mothers compete with other mothers for access to the feed trough, deferring only to aggressive males. Males fight for everything, including feed, shelter, and breeding rights. In the world of goats, if something is not worth fighting for, it is not worth having. The strong survive and flourish, the weak subsist and eventually die." I think this element of competition among these animals that would have been so familiar to Jesus' audience is why he singles the goats out and elevates the sheep. Sheep, by contrast, are very social animals who see themselves as part of a flock. They care about each other. They recognize each other's faces. They've demonstrated emotions for other members of the flock. They defend each other against predators. And it's in this context that we can hear Jesus mentioning what the church calls the 7 works of mercy: feeding the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, giving clothes to the naked, giving shelter to the homeless, visiting the sick and imprisoned, and burying the dead. What I love about the works of mercy is how specific they are. Jesus does not give a very general injunction to care for the unfortunate. He gives concrete instructions for how we are to care for our least brothers and sisters. And they are challenging. Bishop Robert Barron suggests that we use these seven works of mercy as a daily examination of our conscience and ask at night, how have I fed the hungry? How have I given drink to the thirsty? It is particularly challenging to do the works of mercy during a pandemic. I have a student at Mercy, a senior, who is passionate about prison reform and desperately wants to serve the inmate population and has been completely unable to perform that work of mercy this fall due to the pandemic restriction. And so I think the challenge for us is to find ways to put these works of mercy into practice despite the challenge. We might start this Thanksgiving with the people closest to us and extend those works of mercy to them. And I pray that we might also hear at the end of time, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, the words that he directs to his sheep. Come, you blessed. Take your eternal reward that the Father has prepared for you from the beginning.
Now I invite the RCAA candidates to come forward. May Almighty God bless them as they continue to reflect on the Word of God. May God continue to guide them through God's Word as they live and as they make their commitment, as they live their faith. May Almighty God bless them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please all stand to profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things, visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We offer our prayers and petitions to the Father in the name of Christ, our Lord and King.
For the Church, that in times of chaos and confusion, we may be confident that Christ will defeat all evils and lead us to the fullness of life with God.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For the grace to live in the Spirit of Jesus, that we may be shepherds who gather the lost, bind up the injured, and encourage the weak, so that all may know the fullness of life.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For all who are sick, particularly those with COVID-19, that God will bring healing, strengthen caregivers, and preserve all from suffering and death.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For all who are away from home, especially loved ones, members of the military and relief workers, that God will preserve them from harm, give them strength for their service, and lead them home safely.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For Patricia Harpring and all our friends and family who have gone before us, may they be welcomed into eternal life and share in the joy of God's presence forever. And for Catherine Marty, Annie Wolford Lacondro, Peggy Byrne, Lynn Pearson, Irene Ebert, Tony Bueller, Robert Bueller, and Pablito and Avelina Zambillo, whom we remember in a special way in this liturgy.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For the prayers we hold in our hearts today, for our needs, the needs of our family, and the needs of our world.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
God of love and compassion, our refuge and our strength, hear the prayers of your church, and grant us the grace to be ever faithful to you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Please be seated.
make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Break forth and sing for joy, and sing praises. Sing praises to God with the harp, with the harp and the sound of melody, with the trumpet and the sounds of the harp. Make a joyful noise before God the Lord Most High. Let the sea and all that fills it, let the earth and all who dwell in it, let the rivers clap their heads, let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of God, who is coming to judge the earth, to judge the world with righteousness and with equity. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Break forth and sing for joy, and sing praises. Sing praises to God with the harp, with the harp and the sound of melody, with the trumpets and the sounds of the
Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the loving Father. May the Lord accept our sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. As we offer you, O Lord, the sacrifice by which the human race is reconciled to you, we humbly pray that your Son himself may bestow on all nations the gifts of unity and peace through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you anointed your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the oil of gladness as eternal priest and king of all creation, so that by offering himself on the altar of the cross as a spotless sacrifice to bring us peace, he might accomplish the mysteries of human redemption, and making all created things subject to his rule, he might present to the immensity of your majesty an eternal and universal kingdom, a kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son present in our midst when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son in whose body and blood we have communion. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis our Pope and Joseph our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters, inspiring us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command, and may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed apostles and martyrs, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Kingdom, power, and glory.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Here given, we be.
And now I invite Elizabeth to come and share with us the acts of mercy that we can implement in our community.
Hi, everybody. My name is Anna Elizabeth Bodaraco, and I'm a St. Agnes graduate, class of 2018, and am now a junior at Sacred Heart Academy. Service has always been an important part of my life throughout St. Agnes and now at Sacred Heart. This holiday season, I've taken the responsibility of getting involved with Blanket Louisville. As the weather turns colder, Kentuckiana's homeless and less fortunate communities are in greater need for warm blankets. So how can we help as a community? Donations of new or lightly used blankets are accepted and very much appreciated. These donations can be made at the back of the church in the donation bin or at the rectory during the weekdays. I hope you consider donating and have a blessed and safe Thanksgiving.
And every year on Stewardship Week, we always invite one of the stewardship members. Today we invite Joe Lawless to come and share with us and give our gratitude for all the things that we do in our church community.
Thank you, Father Nelson. Good morning, everyone. As he mentioned, my name is Joe Lawless, and I'm here today on behalf of the Stewardship Committee. We learned a few years ago that there are four parts, really, to a stewardship activity within any faith community: explaining what is needed, inviting people to join, following up and making sure people have an opportunity to be engaged in the things they want to be involved with. And I'm here not for those first three, but for the fourth step, which is a really important part, and that is the thank you. You know, for the last probably 4 or 5 or 6 years, maybe a little bit longer, our thank you has been a very special community-wide event. The Chili Supper, tied about 4 years ago to the Pink and Gray Powder Puff football game, and it was a great opportunity to bring our church community, our school children, our families, and everybody together to say thank you. COVID-19, I don't have to tell you, has thrown a wrench into lots of plans this year, and while I can't offer you free chili or beer today, there's a very small token of appreciation from our committee to you. It's a prayer card. The design on the art side is from one of our school students, James Pape, and we very much appreciate that. And one of the prayers that Father Nelson shares with us quite a bit is on the back, thanks to Pope Francis. And like Deacon Ned, I'm going to give you just a little bit of a teaser. There is another small thank you coming to you in the next bell tower, so keep your eye out for that. Thank you very, very much from the Stewardship Committee. And in spite of all of the challenges that we have faced this year with COVID-19, and they're not over yet, certainly, our faith community has been a rock for us, for our local community, and the outreach that we do even beyond that. So we continue to need time, talent, and treasure, but today, that fourth T is the thank you. Very much.
Few words.
And I'd like to invite you to come stand before the altar, and Father Febben, if you could come up and be recognized too. Today is the beginning of the Jubilee, recognizing the 300th anniversary of the foundation of the Congregation of the Passionists. On this day, 300 years ago, St. Paul of the Cross entered a cell in Rome and wrote the rule for the Passionists. And so this is a great day for their community and for us at St. Agnes. And I'd like for us to recognize the priests that we have, Father Nelson and Father Febben, the Passionists that we have in the monastery here, and all those that lie in the graveyard here, representing our history of the Passionists leading our community. If we could recognize them with a round of applause. And then with a prayer as well. Lord, grant on the occasion of the Jubilee of this congregation, as the Passionist family undertakes the renewal of its mission, that through the intercession of Our Mother of Sorrows and St. Paul of the Cross, we may move from standing at the foot of the cross to exercising the ministry of God of compassion, from gazing at Christ on the cross to seeing Christ in the crucified, from mere optimism to trusting in the God of the covenant. Lord, look upon these priests with love, and look upon this congregation with your compassion. And may Almighty God bless you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We always love to have as many blessings we need, especially during this pandemic. So thank you, Ned, for recognizing. And yeah, it's a great honor for all the Passionists throughout the world to begin our 300th year of anniversary. And when the time is good, we will have a big celebration at our church, and when we are able to get together and celebrate. And I will give you an update when we can, and hopefully when the COVID goes off, or maybe in the near future, certainly we will have a big celebration to celebrate the 300 years of anniversary of the Passionist. And I also want to thank Ned, Deacon Ned, for his wonderful reflection this morning. So now we can give a thanks, a round of applause. Since Deacon Ned wanted to learn a lot, so we encourage him as much he can, and he wanted to do the incensing today. He said, this is a good day to start. So today is the King of the Universe, so we need to have this. So we are trying to give him all the experience that he can as a deacon. So we thank Ned and being part of our team, and it is really a blessing to St. Agnes community. Thank you. A few announcements. Thanksgiving Day liturgies are, we will have two liturgies, one at 7 a.m. and another one at 10 a.m. All are welcome. And it is always nice to give thanks to God for all the blessings. And it is a grateful heart is a thankful heart. A grateful heart is a happy heart. So let us come if you can. Make it for either 7 or 10 a.m. would be very much appreciated. And then a variety of Advent devotional resources are available at the back of the church for you to pick up. If you know someone who is unable to come to Mass and might appreciate one, please pick up an extra copy to deliver to him or her. And it is on my left-hand side at the back of the table, so you can help yourself. And again, one of the Advent booklet is one that all the school kids, teachers, parishioners, priests, all put together a reflection for each day during the Advent. And so it would be nice that you read them, a kind of a reflection for each day to make this Advent a meaningful one. And next week we begin our Advent season, and we have masses as usual. And we will have an adoration on Wednesdays, every Wednesdays during the Advent season. And it will be an hour at 7 p.m. So those who can participate would be very much appreciated. Father Febin, Deacon Ned, and myself will be leading the adoration. So it will be also online. And so please, if you could join in person, you're most welcome. If you want to be joined online, you're most welcome to. Please all stand for the final blessing. Let us pray. Having received the food of immortality, we ask, O Lord, that glorifying in obedience to the commands of Christ, the King of the universe, we may live with him eternally in his heavenly kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.